Welcome to The Woman's Connection. I'm Barrie Louise Switzen, your moderator. The Woman's Connection is a program about events shaping women's lives and helping one gain authentic power on a personal or a professional level. So won't you stay tuned?
Welcome. As we age, our health changes. But what is one of the most important things to keep us young and vibrant and healthy? And that's our heart. And with me tonight is Dr. Suzanne Steinbaum, and we're going to talk about our health. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me.
My pleasure. Let's just start. As we age, what should we be concerned about with our health as far as our heart goes?
Well, we know as we get older, women tend to develop heart disease about 10 years after menopause. So as we age, a couple of things happen. The blood pressure increases, the cholesterol increases, and we certainly know that the metabolism changes just a little bit. It starts to get a little harder to keep the weight off, and everything sort of shifts. So as we have an increase in weight, and an increase in high blood pressure, and an increase in cholesterol, we have an increase in the risk factors for heart disease. So then all of a sudden, menopause hits. And what happens is there's an immediate shift, and all the good cholesterol, we start losing it slowly in our systems, and the bad cholesterol, the LDL cholesterol, starts increasing. With the increase of LDL cholesterol and the decrease of HDL, the happy good stuff, and the increase in high blood pressure and the potential increase in weight, we have an increase in risk factors, and that leads to the development of heart disease.
Well, what are some of the symptoms that we should be tuned into as our body changes?
You know, it's interesting. We define heart disease as having symptoms, of having a sensation of chest pain or shortness of breath. But I'd like to sort of redefine that. If we ask people to believe that if they have a risk factor for heart disease, such as high blood pressure, let's call that, for the sake of argument, heart disease, we'll be able to prevent it from happening. And when we really discuss the concept of heart disease, let's talk about blockages in the arteries as being heart disease in this situation. When you develop symptoms, your arteries are already about 70% blocked. Right. We don't want to wait. So I tell all my women patients, let's not talk about heart disease when we have symptoms, but let's talk about the symptoms because it's important. Really, let's address heart disease earlier on. Let's start in our 20s and our 30s and our 40s and before that during that perimenopausal period before we go into menopause. Let's really attack it at that point. So when we get to that 10 years postmenopausal, we're not going to let the heart disease issue become our problem. When you have blockages in the arteries that are 70% or greater, that's when there's problems with blood flow to the heart. So oftentimes we'll hear the word angina. What's angina? Well, angina is when you exercise or when you exert yourself, there's an increase in the demand for oxygen. And when the blockages are 70% or greater, there's a decrease in the supply of oxygen. So that mismatch between demand and supply, or supply and demand, a woman will develop either chest pain or other symptoms. Now, what's so frustrating about women and heart disease is that their symptoms often are different than what we see in men. Men, they have the classic clutching chest pain. We have all seen it in the movies. Women, it's very, very different. There could be shortness of breath. There could be nausea, back pain, jaw pain, sweating, fatigue, very, very different symptoms. So it's often harder to diagnose. And I always say, know your body. Really have an understanding of what your body is. And the more aware you are, if you walk a certain amount during the week, every single day, and all of a sudden you can't do it anymore, that symptom, that change in symptoms might not be the crushing chest pain, but it might be the inability to do the same amount of exercise. That could be your sign that you have heart disease.
Okay, if you have heart disease, does that mean you run to the emergency room if things have changed?
If you have symptoms.
If you have symptoms.
So all of a sudden you have symptoms. One day you wake up and you go to the gym, and you get on the treadmill like you've been doing every single day, and all of a sudden you feel kind of nauseous when you get to that regular place that you usually get to. And then you slow down and you rest and the symptoms go away. That's a very classic sort of picture of heart disease. Symptoms with exertion that are relieved with rest. I would tell you, call the doctor, call your cardiologist. You need a stress test. You need to see if, in fact, you have blockages in the arteries.
What is the biggest risk for heart disease?
The biggest risk factor is the most, I was almost going to say easy, but I don't mean that, is one you can do without, and that's smoking. Never, ever, ever smoke. And there is no such thing as social smoking. Two puffs counts. It's not a good idea. Because every time you smoke, inhale, you get the arteries. The arteries just can't deal with it. And they start to spasm. And once there's injury to the inside of the arteries, I actually equate it to the pocketbook. You know when you have your lining of a pocketbook that gets torn?
Right.
And inside the lining you get gum stuck in there and all of a sudden all these gross things develop in between the lining and the actual leather? That's sort of what plaque is like. There's this filling up inside the arterial wall of schmutz. And what that does is really builds up plaque. And as plaque builds up, that's how it could rupture. Well, the interesting thing is that lining needs to get torn. It needs to have some damage to it. A surefire way of creating damage is smoking. A next surefire way of creating damage is developing diabetes. And diabetes is really a lifestyle issue often. As we tend to get a little older, maybe gain a little belly girth, maybe start eating too many carbohydrates and we get a little heavy. And as that happens, you have the propensity of developing type 2 diabetes. It goes from maybe getting a little heavy to developing something called the metabolic syndrome, which is a difficulty metabolizing sugars. It's associated with that belly girth, with borderline high blood pressure, with low HDL, high triglycerides, and an inability to really process simple carbohydrates. And as that goes on, we develop diabetes. So that's the second way to really work on developing heart disease if you're intentionally going to try and do it.
Let's go back a second. You said that smoking is a no-no.
No.
What about secondhand smoke?
It's an issue. Certainly we have fought in this city to keep smokers away from public places. We now have a radius of which the smokers can huddle in front of a building because of this reason. We know that secondhand smoke is an issue. And actually being in an enclosed area with secondhand smoke can cause a problem. That's why we don't have smoking indoors anymore. It's really a public health problem.
I didn't realize to what extent it was because I just can't deal with the secondhand smoke.
And you're right, your body is telling you what it should be telling you, which is this is toxic. I need to get away from this.
Can heart disease be prevented?
This is when I get on my podium. Absolutely. 80% of the time, heart disease is preventable. So what does that mean? When someone says, I have a family history of heart disease, that's my destiny. The first thing I say is absolutely not. 80% of the time, you can prevent heart disease. Now, how do we do that? We look at the big lifestyle picture. Let's go back to the risk factors. Smoking, diabetes, high cholesterol, high blood pressure, sedentary lifestyle, that means not exercising, and stress. And when you look at these 5% of the time, that's going to lead to heart disease. Only 20% of the time does that family history play a role. Now, that being said, if you have a mother who had heart disease less than age 65 and a father who had heart disease less than 55 or a sibling with heart disease, that increases your risk. And you really, really need to understand that prevention for you needs to start earlier. But everybody can control the risk factors. Everybody can get up every single day and decide they're going to be just a little bit healthier, that they might not have that bagel with butter for breakfast, that they actually might walk to work instead of take a taxi, that they'll take the stairs instead of the elevator. And those little things over time, believe it or not, can change all of these risk factors. If you watch your weight, that alone, you can reduce the incidence of high blood pressure, diabetes, and high cholesterol. If you exercise, that in itself can reduce the incidence of obesity, high blood pressure, and high cholesterol, and stress. So every day I really say to people, get up, make the decision, today I'm going to be healthy. And what am I going to do for myself today? That's the other thing, shift your perspective. It's not a chore, it's not a job, it's not like, oh my God, what am I going to eat? There's nothing to eat. It's really a healthy gift for yourself to eat well, to make choices that are going to make you feel better. It's a gift.
What are some tips that you can suggest for all women to maintain a healthy heart?
As I was just saying, I think that the first step is to make the decision you're going to take care of yourself. First thing. The next thing is we all have to learn how to deal with stress. And I think it's so important that that becomes part of our day, especially now with the economy, with everything that's going on. The amount of stress that we're under is ridiculous. And there is not one person that any of us know that isn't under stress, but it's how you deal with it. And I think part of why I encourage people to exercise so much is because it's such a stress reduction mechanism. Also, the concept of breathing is extraordinarily important. Breathing can actually decrease heart rate and decrease blood pressure and really help with multiple other different issues.
Do you have a way for people to breathe that helps to reduce this?
Absolutely. So the infamous story I always tell is being in the backseat of a taxi cab and being about already 10 minutes late for the meeting, and I look around and there's bumper-to-bumper traffic and I'm trying to get to the meeting and now I am 15 minutes late and clearly this is a disaster, and you get that sensation, your heart is pounding and you're having difficulty breathing, and right there you can make the choice. I'm either going to let this get into a complete panic attack or I'm going to breathe. And really what I recommend is really to take a breath in through the nose for the count of six and out through the mouth through the count of four. And it's, don't you feel calmer already?
I feel much calmer. My heart's not pounding as much.
But it's really that simple. And just to do that three, four times in back of the taxi, in that moment, all of a sudden you will feel extraordinarily different. The next thing that I will tell you are the simple, simple things you can do every day, which is really about the diet, where you're going to start being healthy, what you're going to do to maintain heart health. And one of the things that I do recommend to promote heart health is something like an omega-3 fatty acid. This is a vitamin supplement that you can take to promote heart health, a very simple thing to do. Personally, I take krill oil, which is a very small tablet, very easy to digest. No aftertaste, no gross fishy thing that some of them have. And it actually helps to reduce cholesterol and to reduce blood pressure. And really, it's part of the heart-healthy lifestyle that we all try to achieve. And then making the best choices for diet. Again, put down the bagel, put down the donut, step away from Dunkin' Donuts. Excuse me. You can step in. Just make good choices. But it's really about what you're going to choose to be the most heart healthy. And what that's about are lean meats, or really a diet that's filled with fruits and vegetables and lean proteins, I'll say, fish, for example. Think about being in the Mediterranean, just all the food surrounding you there. That's really the healthiest diet that you can. And part of that diet for me is really having the most appropriate supplements, like the omega-3 fatty acids, the krill oil, or a vitamin D supplement. We know vitamin D is associated with all forms of high blood pressure and cancers, and also taking a vitamin D supplement might be an important part of your diet. And lastly, my last tip really is the exercise and taking every opportunity you can to move, to walk, to take the stairs, to move your body. And that old phrase, if you don't use it, you lose it, that's a reality. And the more you can do for yourself, the better in terms of physical activity.
How does progesterone play an active part or an inactive part with your health? I mean, as far as your heart goes.
Well, here's what happens. So let's talk about just the process of menopause. We really go through this period of losing our estrogen, and we talk about supplements, hormone replacement, and this is obviously quite a controversial subject and has been over the years, whether you take estrogen or estrogen and progesterone together. And it really depends on if you have your uterus, if you don't have your uterus, because women have hysterectomies, right? And so hormone replacement is something that is very personal. I think it's something that I would never talk about generally recommending for all women, because it really depends on who you are. Do you have a family history of heart disease? Do you have a hysterectomy? How old are you when we talk about estrogen and progesterone? And all of these things are very, very important. But hormones clearly are part of what keeps us young, keeps us vital, what's part of the aging process. But it's a process. I remember years ago reading something about menopause, and there was a statement that said, menopause is not an illness. And I thought, well, that's a really strange statement. Whoever said it was? And I think what I've learned over the years is, through everything, it's almost you have to train for life. You have to go in this process of training, meaning you train for a marathon, you get up to prepare for that, and eating right and exercising appropriate to that. Well, I say the same thing about menopause or about going through the hormonal cycles. Train for menopause. And studies have shown that, in fact, if you do, if you exercise and diet, all of those things that we hear about, the hot flashes and not sleeping and the mood swings, you have a much easier time. So in training for menopause, you can actually go through it easier. And not only is it not an illness, it in some ways can be the best time of your life. Because that shift in hormones actually allows you to have a different part of your brain switch on, which allows you to enter a different phase of life. And for some women, it's the greatest time of life.
That's what I hear.
That's what I hear. That's what I hear.
At different times, you said, you know, your heart will race. What if you're going to sleep and it's pounding, or you get all these anxieties and boom, boom, yeah, boom? What's that all about?
I love talking about this pounding in the chest, because I hear this from women of all ages. Palpitations, irregular heartbeat, arrhythmias, these are all synonyms that I hear in my office constantly. It's such an interesting phenomenon, because I'm not sure if we always understand it, but I see a lot of women going through menopause as they lose their estrogen, and all of a sudden there is this sensation of palpitations, arrhythmia, extra heartbeats. And in fact, the reality is sometimes there are early extra beats that occur, and we call those ventricular premature contraction, or VPCs. And really what it feels like is a bump, 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 bump. And it can be very, very annoying more than anything. The good news is, if they happen one at a time, they're not dangerous. They can't kill you. They're just irritating. So why did those occur? Why sometimes when you go to sleep at night do you really get these sensations? Well, first of all, you're relaxed, so you're paying attention. Instead of going about your day and running around, all of a sudden you're paying attention. But these early extra beats oftentimes can happen from not sleeping enough, dehydration, stress, caffeine, nobody has these things. Mix these all together, and you know, this is a typical New Yorker's day. And it's common, it's very common. So when I divide it up amongst who is this going to occur to, well, if you don't sleep and you drink caffeine, or maybe had a couple of cocktails the night before, you're a little dehydrated, exercising, not drinking enough water, you can have these early ventricular beats. If you are going through menopause or even premenstrual or having a shift in hormones for whatever reason, this is often a time these extra beats will occur. And I often hear it mostly during times of stress. And that could be from extra beats in the top part of the heart called supraventricular tachycardia or atrial premature contractions. These are early extra beats in the top part of the heart that can occur one at a time or in a row. One at a time, again, not dangerous, can't kill you, irritating. Get some sleep, stop the caffeine, drink some water, no more cocktails, and it'll probably go away. But when they occur in a row, as in the supraventricular tachycardia or something called atrial fibrillation, this is something you really need to see a doctor about. So I would tell you that's a time to go get an EKG, make sure there's nothing else going on. Thyroid, having a hyperthyroid or a hypothyroid, that can actually also cause these. So going to your doctor, getting a blood test might be important. I tell all women, the more you know your body, the more you pay attention to who you are and what your symptoms are, the better off you are. Because once you know what it feels like to be you, when you're not you that day, that might be the time that you need to seek some medical attention. Not only should you know your body, but know your cholesterol, know your blood pressure, get checked. I tell all women who are older to tell their daughters, whisper in their ear, there's no such thing as social smoking. Take your daughters, take the younger generation to get checked early. So prevention can happen before the menopausal period. I see a trend now. A lot of us didn't have babies till later. And a lot of us are having trouble having babies now. So there's a new trend that I see with women who are going through later fertility or having fertility drugs and have babies. And then all of a sudden, menopause occurs a little sooner than we thought it was going to occur. So prevention needs to happen sooner than we thought. Let's not wait until we're 50 or 60. Let's really start young. But if you do start when you're 50 or 60 or 70, it is not too late. Because all the studies show that the day you change your life, the day you quit smoking, or the day that you start exercising, changes the outcome of heart disease and what could potentially be your future. Empower yourself. That's my speech.
Let's talk about cholesterol again. You were saying the high and the low, and then there's the triglycerides. And what does it mean when you've got this number and that number, and why is it separate and why is it combined?
When we are younger, estrogen does amazing things for us. It allows our hearts to stay protected with HDL. HDL is the happy, the higher the better, the good cholesterol. And as we get older, we lose the protection from estrogen and the HDL drops. L, lousy, the lower the better. Triglycerides, that's what comes from eating too many simple sugars, carbohydrates. And that actually, believe it or not, has been shown to increase the risk of heart disease in women. So be very careful with your simple sugar and your carbohydrate intake, because high triglycerides in women leads to heart disease more than it does in men. But oftentimes I see women come into my office and they say, my doctor over the years said I was fine because I have a high HDL and that's okay and I'm okay. And then I look at the profile and in fact the LDL, the bad stuff, is high. And that's between 130, say, and 160, this mid-range of being high. Well, then we start talking, and it turns out that my patient in front of me has high blood pressure and has a family history of heart disease. And all of a sudden, that ratio and having that high HDL cholesterol might not matter anymore. how we really judge each woman, that's a horrible word, how we risk stratify each woman is by really looking at her risk factors and saying, is there high blood pressure? Is there high cholesterol? Is there diabetes? Do you smoke? Do you have a family history? And go through all the risk factors, and then we can come up with sort of an assessment. Are you at risk for developing heart disease, and over what period of time? And if we check off, yes, high blood pressure, yes, high cholesterol, if you have multiple risk factors, then putting the HDL aside, we want that LDL, that bad stuff, to be less than 100. And so that HDL and that ratio becomes less important. The blood pressure. This also has become more stringent. The guidelines are more stringent. 130 over 85 that we used to say, oh, it's borderline, that's actually pre-hypertension. We want our blood pressures to be 120 over 80 or less. Sugar. Checking a fasting sugar, it should be less than 100. There's no more of this 120 or above is diabetes. If your fasting sugar is greater than 100, you're in a pre-diabetic condition. So all the prevention guidelines are actually stricter now. And we really, again, need to understand making the changes sooner than later is really the most important thing we can do.
What do you recommend if somebody has all these? I should ask you, what do you think of stents? Is that what they're called?
Yes. So let's talk about stents. When do we get a stent? Well, when we first started this discussion, we talked about symptoms. And when I mentioned symptoms, I said those develop when the blockages are 70% or greater. Stents are very, very useful in two situations. If you have blockages 70% or greater and the medications are not keeping away your chest pain, not helping you, that is a great situation for a stent. Or if someone is having a heart attack or what we call an acute coronary syndrome, where there is an impending massive heart attack, there are some parts of the heart muscle that are dying, that's when a stent goes in. And short of that, it's diet, exercise, and taking care of yourself. And sometimes medication fits into that.
Well, I was going to ask you about the medication because a lot of people are on statins for the cholesterol.
Absolutely.
Can't you go on a vitamin instead of a statin?
I think our first step is always, 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 always diet, exercise, vitamins first. I think we always have the obligation to ourselves to try that first. And then, if that doesn't work, then sometimes really statins are important. If you have heart disease, blockages in the arteries, stents, bypass surgery, anything like that, then absolutely 150% across the board you need to be on a statin and an aspirin. But for people who have risk factors, diet, exercise, vitamin supplementation, omega-3, krill oil, those sort of things, try that first. And then if it doesn't work. There's a study that came out recently looking at inflammation. And in people who have inflammation, statins have been shown to reduce morbidity and mortality, which really has increased the role of statins across the board. When it comes down to it, diet, exercise first, and that will potentially reduce the inflammation. Inflammation is also a risk factor for heart disease and something that we have to understand as being part of this big picture. But it all comes down to the lifestyle issues and then really the medication second.
Doctor, I want to thank you so much. I mean, I've learned so much about my heart,
oh, good.
What I can do and what I can't do. And if you have any questions that you would like to ask the doctor, please write us here at the Woman's Connection, and she'll be glad to answer them.
That's great.
Thank you.